Good morning, and I'd like to welcome everyone to the 10th meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2022. And we have a number of interesting evidence sessions this morning. The first is to consider on continued petitions, petition number 1865, suspend all surgical mesh and fixation devices, a subject that this committee has been preoccupied with, it seems, coming up for almost a decade itself, 10 meetings in 10 years, it almost feels, of this important issue. This one has been lodged by Rosanna Clarkin and Lauren McDougall and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to suspend the use of all surgical mesh and fixation devices while a review of all surgical procedures which use polyester, polypropylene or titanium is carried out, and while guidelines for the surgical use of mesh are established. Now, interestingly, we've previously met with the Minister. Welcome to you again. Thank you very much for being with us, Mary Todd. And we're delighted to have with us this morning the Chief Medical Officer, Sir Gregor Smith. Good morning to you. And back with us, but online, is Terry O'Kelly. Good morning to you, Mr. O'Kelly, as well. And in our last consideration of this petition was online with Shoulders Hospital in Canada, where we were able to take evidence from Dr. Fernando Spencer Neto. So there'll be a number of questions arising from all of the evidence that we've heard. And I think as we've gone along, I think that we've heard a lot of evidence that, you know, there are very many people who've benefited positively from mesh in relation to hernia. But I wonder if I could just start with a couple of back questions, Minister, just if you don't mind, since this might be the last time we really cover mesh in quite such wide detail. In relation to the Act that we passed for transvaginal mesh, there have been some reports that we're still at a stage of trying to negotiate.
Excuse me, I actually have an open statement.
Ah,
I'd like to hear it.
I very much would, yes, thank you.
No further, and that might set the context and
excellent.
Answer
thanks
some
very
of
much.
The questions you're keen to put to me. So thanks very much for inviting me along and giving me the opportunity to return to this really important topic again. I'm pleased to say that we have made significant progress in our action on transvaginal mesh. We've established a national service for the management of mesh complications, and women have options with regard to their treatment, which can be undertaken in Scotland, elsewhere in the UK, and also with an independent provider if desired. Most recently, the Transvaginal Mesh Removal Cost Reimbursement Scotland Act 2022 was introduced, and the associated scheme opened on the 6th of June, just this Monday. The contract with Spire Healthcare has been concluded and arrangements are being made for the first patients to attend surgery. And meanwhile, discussions with Dr. Veronicus are progressing. I am, of course, very mindful of the concerns raised by campaigners over the year about the use of mesh in other sites, such as in hernia repair. And that is what I'd like to focus on today. I'm very sorry to hear of instances of any complications and the adverse effect that these have had on both them as individuals and on their wider families. As you know, the Scottish Health Technologies Group have looked into the use of mesh in hernia repair and have published two reports on this subject, one shortly after my last committee appearance. These reports, based on current published evidence, support the continued use of mesh in a variety of abdominal wall and groin herniae, of course, subject to all the tenets of realistic medicine, ensuring shared decision-making, informed consent with knowledge of benefits, risks, alternative measures, and the possibility of doing nothing. We've discussed the findings of these reports with professional bodies, including the Royal Colleges and the British Hernia Society, and we'll continue to work with them on this important issue. There's also work ongoing with regard to establishing MDIS, which will provide important surveillance and outcome information. Since I last appeared before committee, the Chief Medical Officer wrote to the Board Chief Executives and Medical Directors in December 21 to draw their attention to the SHTG report. In the letter, the CMO asked health boards to consider the availability of non-mesh surgery and how best to address skill gaps if they exist in the development of broader clinical networks for the management of complex cases. The actions resulting from this will be discussed at a meeting of the Scottish Association of Medical Directors in August. I know that the committee have received a report from the Shoulders Hospital in Canada, and whilst the results reported are absolutely indeed notable, it's important to remember that the Shoulders Hospital is a specialist centre dedicated to natural tissue repair and that it operates in a very different healthcare system to the NHS in Scotland. And for that reason, the report shouldn't be considered in isolation, but it needs to be considered in the context of the wider evidence available. As I've said before in front of this committee, there are, of course, still some gynaecology procedures for which the use of mesh has not been halted. In those circumstances, there's a high vigilance protocol in place across the whole of NHS Scotland. And it's important to remember that some of these procedures are complex and long established with few, if any, viable alternatives. So to suspend the use of mesh would leave a cohort of people with limited or no treatment options. I want to reassure the committee members, as well as the campaigners who brought this petition forward, that the government is absolutely committed to ensuring that everyone with mesh complications gets the care and treatment that they need. And I look forward to answering any questions you might have on the matter.
Thank you, Minister. That's very helpful. And I think as we've heard the evidence in relation to this second area of mesh concern, the evidence very much supports the view that there are nuances here which mean that the way in which the future might be progressed is quite different to the prognosis that there was in relation to the transvaginal mesh campaign. You alluded there to the ongoing conversations with Dr. Veronicus, and that, of course, has been negotiations continue, has really been the situation for us for as long as I can recall. In fact, I might even have been a List MSP when we first heard that said. And I recognise that there is a commercial interest in the Missouri facility that Dr. Veronicus operates. And I know that the conversations at times have been strained, but inherent in the act that was passed was a belief that that would be one of the options that would be identified and around which something would be concluded. And naturally enough, expectations are therefore raised that something will be forthcoming that can assist women in the near future. Some will have thought even sooner potentially than we are at now. Is it difficult to say where we are in those negotiations and how they are proceeding?
I mean, I have to commend NSS, the NHS organisation who are pursuing conclusion of that contract. They are very close, I think, to finalising it. I know it's frustrating, but I think when we stop and reflect about the differences in the medical systems and in the legal systems in the two countries, it's understandable that there is has been a deal of toing and froing, but I'm confident that everything is being done to conclude that contract, and I hope to be able to update Parliament on that soon.
Okay, thank you. And just one further back follow-up question. As we've been discussing, talking about the nuances in relation to hernia mesh, again, it's been at times about the proper explanation to patients of options. And that was partly one of the things that Professor Alison Britton was looking at in relation to the casework review and the way that women progressing through the transvaginal hernia mesh issue had been treated. Now, her inquiry has now been ongoing for some time, and I did ask an oral question a month or so ago in Parliament, and I just wonder if you're able to offer any update as to where that might be, because some of what she might report might also be of interest in relation to the way in which patients have to be properly notified and made aware of the options that are available to them.
Absolutely. The review is now underway and it's been established following the serious concerns that were raised by some of the women on whether their case records accurately reflected the treatment that they've received. It's well underway and it's expected to conclude later this year. But I have to say, we have a system in Scotland, and I'm sure Sir Gregor Smith will want to come in on this, around realistic medicine, where we want all patients at all times to be well informed and part of the decision-making process. And, you know, we talk about, we use the acronym BRAN, you know, to remind everybody involved to consider the benefits, risks, alternatives. Is the intervention needed now? What happens if I do nothing? And these sorts of conversations are absolutely vitally important when considering surgery. There is no risk-free option when you have a hernia, and it's really important that people are well able to question and understand the treatment and not just the generality of it, not just what the general risks are, but how those risks apply to them in order to make a full informed decision about how they want to proceed. I'll let Gregor say some more.
So thank you. Shared decision-making really is at the heart of the relationship between people who receive care and people who provide care. It's realistic medicine. When we began to have a conversation with the profession late 2015, we saw the need to promote a better approach to shared decision-making and personalised care has been right at the heart of realistic medicine, to try to kind of create a much more equal relationship between patients and providers of care. And since that point in time, shared decision making has been, I would say, absolutely wholeheartedly embraced by the profession in terms of the approach. It's been supported very much through work that we have participated in with the General Medical Council on refreshing the ethical obligations and legal obligations around consent, but it's also been greatly supported by our education establishments, whether that be in undergraduate education or in postgraduate education through NHS Education for Scotland, with several modules really promoting what is the essence of shared decision making. And these four questions that the Minister has outlined, known by the abbreviation BRAN: what are the benefits, what are the risks, what are the alternatives, and what would happen if I did nothing, are really at the heart of consultations. Now, we have them as part of the Near Me platform, the electronic platform that has been used extensively over the last 2 years, has now increased its presence across the country, but also in outpatient letters as well, really encouraging patients to engage with the clinical teams, to use these questions to make sure that they're exploring these concepts, and so that when they arrive at a decision, it's a decision that is well informed, that can be said to be informed consent, that underpins that. And we know that in a situation like that, it's associated with much less treatment regret afterwards if that conversation has happened fully.
I mean, I think, Sir Gregor, if the evolution of this exchange and shared decision making has materially progressed from the fact that such a process was meant to be the one that was there historically, but we discovered during the transvaginal mesh issue wasn't really there. If that has happened, then I think that's a great and a very positive development. And I should say, Mr. Kelly, I've got a very good video feed of you, so at any time you feel you'd like to say something, if you just raise a hand, I'll know immediately that you're trying to come in. So don't feel you've got to do anything more. I can see you well. Minister, the last time we met, in relation to the extent to which there is a valid underpinning of the concerns that the petitioners have had, you thought it would be very difficult to quantify this because there was no basis really of evidence gathering that would allow a material judgment to be made about the extent to which anything is real. Has any thought been given to some sort of limited sampling or anything just to get some understanding of how many people may be experiencing genuine post hernia mesh complications?
So I'm not sure I entirely understand what... Do you mean sampling of records or sampling of data? So, yeah. I mean, certainly there's a recognition that we need to, particularly where medical devices are used, they need to be more traceable, and it needs to be clearer which devices were used where, and there needs to be a system of retrieval in place. And we're working very closely with the UK on that, so that in future... And I guess that answers your question, is that we found ourselves in a situation where it was quite hard to tell what had happened precisely. But in future, that data should be gathered much more routinely, and certainly where there are issues with a product, it should be perfectly straightforward to find where that product has been used. There should be a strong audit trail present in a patient's notes.
Okay, thank you. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, you talked about the risks and also the benefits, but within all of this, the word complication seems to be the problem. And we have had many individuals who have given us their testimony that they took on good faith and went through that process, but maybe 3, 4, 5 years on, then the situation became so difficult for them that it ended up being a real problem. for some individuals who found themselves in that situation. So you've talked about consent and you've talked about that process, but it's about communication. And I believe that anyone who goes in and gets medical support and advice will take on board that, but maybe didn't realise what complications could occur maybe 3, 4, 5 years later on, and the damage that has then been done. And that's where we've seen also in the hernia situation, where people in good faith thought that the mesh was the right thing to do because that was what they were advised at the time, but it ended up not being, and has put them in a really difficult and dangerous situation. So it would be good to just get a clarity as to how you communicate that to ensure that individuals do make the right choices, and they're not steamrolled or advised, well, you know, the doctor or the clinician saying, well, we believe this is the best treatment for you. And they take that on good faith. But as I say, years later, they find that maybe was not what should have been happening.
So I'll certainly, I see Mr. O'Kelly raising his hand. I'm sure he's very keen to contribute here as a practising surgeon who has to go through these issues time and time again, day in, day out with patients. I think you're absolutely on the button. It's really important that these decisions are shared, and that's kind of what we're talking about with realistic medicine. So moving away from, in the past, we had a very paternalistic style of medicine where the doctor was all-powerful and it told the patient what to do, and their advice was almost always taken as law. And what we're recognising now is that, you know, health is much better delivered in a shared way. You're much more likely to attain good health if you share that decision making, and individuals have to be a party to that decision. There has to be a discussion with their clinicians about. And as I said, you know, it's not just about the generality, it's about how those risks apply to them as individuals. So it's a very individual discussion. And, you know, a patient should feel like, rather than, you know, accessing the internet and finding the data and assessing that themselves, they should feel like they are able to talk to their own health professional and have those risks explained as they apply to them as they make the decision. Often patients are in a very difficult situation where there isn't a risk-free option. So if you have a hernia, continuing with that hernia is not a comfortable situation to be in, and the options for treating it are never going to be risk-free. And it's about that discussion, as you say, an honest and transparent and well-documented discussion about those risks is a very important part of the process. Then I think the second thing that you were probably raising with me is the sense that sometimes, and I certainly as a politician, and we as politicians probably hear more of this than it actually happens. In you know, we hear a certain select few stories, or select many stories, but we hear often from people who feel like they weren't listened to. So they go to their health professional and they feel like their concerns were dismissed or their health problems were minimised. And again, we're working hard to improve that situation so that people, when they do present to a healthcare professional, who often, you know, 5 years on won't be the surgeon. So we're trying to make sure that their response that they receive is more empathetic, more understanding, and they are suitably directed to people who might be able to help them disentangle whether what they're experiencing is related to the surgery that they had or not. Mr. O'Kelly, I'm sure, would like to come in and
yes, I think Mr. O'Kelly would like to just contribute as well. And good morning, Mr. O'Kelly, and over to you.
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Cavine and committee. And I may well have raised my hand too early, actually. That was a very good explanation by the minister. I think there, the issue about complications is difficult. And I think it's in explaining complications, don't flood them with data and cause anguish about, you know, it's inevitable something dreadful is going to happen, because look at all the things that can happen. But I think in that is, A, trying to allay fears that the risks are relatively small, in that the risk might be less than 5% or less than 2%. But if you are the person that complication affects, then it isn't a nebulous concept of a less than 1% risk. It is 100%. It's happened to me. And I think there is a notion of an importance of trying to ensure patients understand what the nature of the risk that they are exposing themselves to. I think it is, and I think we know from realistic medicine and the work that's gone on, that health literacy in Scotland is by no means ideal. And so there is a need for clinicians to spend time with patients to ensure that not only have they told them or given them information, but that information has been assimilated and truly understood. I think in that respect, it is always a good idea, I think, to check. I think it's always a good idea to ask patients to attend with a supporter or an advocate if required, particularly when there are perhaps one is engaging in a more invasive and perhaps more risky procedure. Yeah, I think that's very important. And I think that probably is you know, the crucial things. The other thing also is, and I think it comes down back to comments that you remember that Donald Rumsfeld made, and that was that there are the known knowns, and you know, we know the complications, we've looked at those. There are the unknown unknowns. We can't tell you about what's going to happen in 10 years because this product has not been available for that period of time, and we don't know what the outcome is going to be over time, so there is a risk there. But as he said, I think at the time, there are the unknown unknowns, and they're the ones that always catch us out. And I'm not suggesting at all that my colleagues in the past have always addressed themselves in glory, but I think it is that recognition of being absolutely honest with patients, saying, we don't know what's going to happen in 10 years' time because this particular device, this particular product, this particular drug has not been available for that time. So it's impossible for us to know. What we do recognise is at this moment, and given the timeframes that we have experience of, this will be of benefit for you. And this, these are the reasons, these are the risks that we know of, these are the alternatives, and this is what might happen if we did nothing. So I think that there's quite a lot there, but for the patient sitting in a doctor's surgery, that's quite a lot to actually to take on board. And I think, as Gregor was saying, the importance of it's not only the questions, but it's flattening the hierarchy, having the right attitudes, making it the giving the patient the right environment where they feel they're able to speak up and ask questions.
Alexander Stewart.
From both comments from the Minister and from Sir Kelly there, do we have some understanding about mesh itself, because different types of mesh may well have different processes within the case. So how have we been in investigating and taking steps to analyse some of the mesh products themselves as to what kind of defects they may have? And has the government and clinicians themselves have had a look at any of that history to try and find out if there are defects that happen specifically in some types of mesh products that are more susceptible or more problematic for individuals? Because I think that would once again give some reassurance if we're aware that certain products may be more susceptible than other products, and that may reassure people in the future that they believe that the mesh that is being put in will be better because it's not one that maybe has a track record that has caused some issues in the past. Minister, maybe you first.
I think I'll let Mr. O'Kelly answer the bulk of this question, and he can certainly give you the picture of what clinicians are doing to understand, you know, as with medicines, it is possible to do randomised controlled trials with these medical devices and learn more and more about them. And also, as with the unit in Canada, it's possible to collect anecdotal evidence and observational evidence as well. And that does happen on an ongoing basis in this area of medicine, as in any other area of medicine. If I go back to your concern about how you know, finding out about these types of mesh and which may have defects or not, the Cumberledge report was very focused on the regulation of medical devices and found the UK environment wanting, actually. And we as a government are absolutely committed to the recommendations made by the Baroness and her team. And we've made significant progress on them since the report was published last year.
Mr. O'Kelly, you want to maybe answer some of that too?
So I think with regard to the base material, polypropylene, that has been used in surgery for 80 years. I think it was introduced at the time, maybe Second World War, perhaps just afterwards. So, and that has been found to be very safe, very effective, and well tolerated by patients. And certainly in vascular surgery, it is product of choice. As a suture material, it is we know over time that there have been no major safety issues raised. With regard to mesh itself, that has evolved over time, and I think with regard to hernia mesh, the MHRA have looked at this, as you know, and I know there are issues with MHRAs sitting in front of this committee, but it has been scrutinised very carefully. You'll appreciate that, both in this country and also by similar organisations in the States, the FDA. And I think what they recognise is that this is an implanted product. It is important that patients understand, but there doesn't seem to be an intrinsic issue with the product itself. There are some reports, rare reports in the press, in published literature, of patients having some reactions, but these are very, very rare. And given the numbers of meshes that are used each year and the time that they've been used for, going back to the late 1980s, we see very few patients, or rather a very low percentage of patients coming back. Because these are common procedures, even rates of less than 1% mean that there are a number of patients each year that do have troubles with problems related to their surgery. And yes, they have got a foreign body in the mesh, it's not necessarily the mesh itself that has been the problem. Modern mesh construction is, I think, probably as good as we're going to get it at the moment with this base material. There's allows ingrowth of fibrous material, a scar tissue, which causes a fibrous scar and strengthens repair. Problems can occur over time with a degree of shrinkage, contraction of that fibrous scar, which can lead to problems. I think it's important that the mesh is inserted in a tension-free fashion, therefore the possibility of causing injury is less, and also that if it is used in a position where the bowel might come into contact with it, the steps are taken to avoid that as much as is possible.
We've heard that in some situations individuals had one mesh for a hernia put in and then that had to be removed and had a second one, and on the second attempt things have been better. They have not had the same complications once they've had the first mesh removed and the second one implanted. Now, can I maybe ask, is there evidence from yourself and others of that procedure when one is removed and a new one is replaced? Is that common, or is that just an ad hoc situation for certain individuals?
I suspect that's an ad hoc situation, and I don't know the circumstances or the individual circumstances that related to the case that you quote. If let's say a mesh was put in and it was tight, it can happen. These are technical exercises, and sometimes the might be too tight. So that removing that mesh, putting in a tension-free mesh, might be the answer. It is also possible if the mesh is inserted and held in place by sutures, that a suture entraps a nerve. You might not be able to see that at the time, and that's very likely. And that physically removing that foreign body from the vicinity of the nerve might have actually alleviated the patient's symptoms, but it might be necessary to remove the mesh to do that. And it may be that the second mesh, when inserted, was self-adhering or inserted and held in place with the tissue glue. So there are reasons. Why in a car does something not work and you get a change and it works now? And it's just difficult to know precisely what the issue was in every circumstance.
Thank you, convener.
It's not common.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. O'Kelly. Minister, sorry, just in relation to the Cumberledge report, this committee, of course, was alert to the shortcomings in the regimen surrounding the MHRA, and I think all parties here in the Parliament endorsed the recommendations in the Cumberledge report. I did I understand you to say, though, that you do believe the discussions that are taking place in relation to that are constructive and are progressing to a positive a positive kind of outcome?
So certainly we are working with that report and taking positive steps in the Scottish Government. There is still work to do to ensure that patients' voices are heard and listened to, and that's why we are have proposed a patient safety commissioner in our programme for government, and it was also a manifesto commitment. So we've consulted on that recently. The consultation has now closed, and we recently published a report that provided an analysis of the results of that. We're certainly going to take that into account as we continue to work forward as patients and experts and develop that commissioner role, but we're keen to do that in Scotland, and we're keen to deliver what patients are asking for on that front. In terms of discussions UK-wide with the MHRA, I think we there have, as has often been the case over the last couple of years, some slow progress, understandably given the situation that we are in. But we are pretty keen to pick that up as a priority and make sure that we make progress UK-wide.
I mean, I think all parties here recognise that, this the MHRA kind of regulation is reserved, but I think there was a very strong feeling that wherever support could be given to efforts that were being made by the Scottish Government in relation to progressing issues around the regulation of these devices, that would be forthcoming, and I'm sure all parties would still be willing and offer and able to offer whatever support the government felt it might need if it was struggling to sort of make the progress that we would all want to see, I think.
We'll bear that in mind and take up your offer if needed.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Convener, and thanks for your contribution so far. Very interesting. I have some questions around mesh removal procedures and protocols. So we've had a number of written submissions from members of the public, patients who have experienced adverse outcomes and the complications. Martin O'Neill commented that his life is now improving, that he's had mesh removed. His statement reads as follows: I'm still mesh afflicted due to the device being left so long in my body that the pain and damage is permanent, but I have some hope that it's now out. There is at least a possibility of me doing something with life rather than taking pills that don't allow basic functioning, coupled with pain that still doesn't stop, sleepless nights and an overwhelming sense of wanting to die than live in that horror of the pain that the mesh is causing. In other cases, individuals were told by surgeons that the mesh was too enmeshed in their body to be removed without causing serious consequences, such as the loss of their rectum or testicles. And some individuals have resorted to private surgery to get their mesh removed, and some have even travelled abroad to do so. In another written submission, Carol Coutts described difficulties in getting her mesh removed on the NHS in Scotland, and her submission reads as follows: my GP discussed my case with other GPs. She said that none of them knew much about mesh. She tried referring me to the Scottish Complex Mesh Surgical Service, which is a service for women considering specialist surgical mesh removal, and she also emailed them as a patient, and they refused my referral as they only accept gynaecological referrals. And then in 2018, your predecessor, Sir Gregor, as Chief Medical Officer, wrote to the Health Board Medical Directors in Scotland about the use of mesh in sites other than the vagina. And in the letter that the CMO wrote, it reads as follows: the management of patients with mesh-related complications must follow agreed pathways, which should involve a multidisciplinary team of clinicians with appropriate skills and experience. So in light of that, what specifically, can you talk us through those agreed pathways for non-gynecological mesh-related complications referred to by your predecessor in 2018, and do you believe these pathways are operating in a way that they should? Thanks.
So first of all, it's, when you recount the stories, such as you've just done, the terrible symptoms that some people are suffering as a consequence of some types of surgery, it's always very difficult, and you can't help but be moved by their experience at all. Terry will be able to say a little bit about the detail of some of the pathways, but you're absolutely right in that we have created an expectation in boards that they should be developing pathways that both offer alternatives to mesh surgery for patients who would prefer to explore other options, but also where there are complications that may necessitate further revision surgery, or to be able to explore that in a place which is has a specialist nature for that when that's required as well. Within each health board, there are what's called exceptional referral protocols. And so what happens just now, and that's happened for many years, is that when particularly specialist services where a high degree of competency is required, where perhaps in a local board area, but perhaps that service isn't available in a local board area, there's the ability for local staff to be able to refer outside that board to these places using that exceptional referral protocol. Now, sometimes that's to another area within Scotland, sometimes that's even beyond Scottish borders where there's a service which is provided from elsewhere. And that traditionally has been one of the ways of trying to deal with this. There's many surgeons with a high level of competency in Scotland in addressing some of the issues that you've described, particularly in terms of the more complex end of mesh removal. But I think what I would like to see, and what the reasons that my predecessor and then again myself have written to health boards about, is to see a greater consistency across Scotland in terms of developing more localised services for that type of care. Now, as I say, Mr O'Kelly might be able to say a little bit more about progress with that. We've heard that later on this year there'll be some more detailed discussions with the Scottish Association of Medical Directors as to what progress has been made following that letter, which was sent to them. I think it was just towards the end of 2021, perhaps December 2021. But Mr O'Kelly might be able to say a little bit more just now.
I think it's a couple of things. I think it is not only that clinicians recognise that there may be a need for a second opinion, but also it's the patient's right, I think, that if they are not receiving information or opinions which they are satisfied with, that they are able to ask themselves, well, could I see somebody else for a second opinion? And I think as a practicing a surgeon, I think there's a great deal of security in A, asking somebody else to review a case, and it not only helps me, but it also helps the patient. And I think that's something that we need to support. I think with regard to pathways, I think these are going to be germane to each circumstance, not because the hernias and the meshes and all the procedures and the complications that have occurred will, because they're not that common, they will be bespoke. So it's important that care is individualised, so it's very much centred on that particular patient. I think it's important that clinicians form networks, and in my own health board, that certainly is the case. I think the networks need some support, and particularly administrative support, and it's essential, really, that any discussions that occur are recorded and discussed with the patient, and the outcome of all the deliberations entered into the electronic patient record to go forward in perpetuity. So there's a bit of work, I think, still to be done to ensure that that type of process is embedded into every board in Scotland. And I think with regard to private healthcare, I think it's a real shame that still there's the sort of perception that if I pay for something, I'm going to get it better. And I think that it's often the same people. I think what we need to be able to do is provide for all our patients exemplary care within our National Health Service. And certainly, I think we're all committed to do that.
Mr. Sweeney?
Thank you.
Slightly anticipated a question I think they might have asked, but...
Thanks for that contribution. And I think the point about... there's such a small number of cases in the national scale of things requires some degree of reflection on how best to address it. And I think these pathways perhaps need some consideration about how do you get these learning curves established so that defects can be addressed by a network of people who are robustly capable of doing it rather than it being a lottery. And I think I just wanted to ask, is there a specific protocol? Could the NHS consider a particular protocol of investigating these particular cases where, for example, someone's went for a private surgical solution, understanding why they did that, what was the outcome, what could have happened differently? Is there a way of actually addressing some of the submissions we've had from patients and doing a deeper analysis of what's actually gone wrong through their journey to sort of identify whether there are opportunities for improvement?
Audit is an incredibly important part of learning within medicine or surgery, and the ability to be able to reflect and practice and to get good data and evidence of how practice has affected people, what kind of outcomes they've experienced, whether those are positive, whether those are, on these occasions, negative outcomes. And it relies upon the availability of good data. Now, some of the things that we've heard about today, such as even just the kind of scan for safety type approaches where we're able to have much greater information about the type of devices or materials that are used in different types of surgery, help us to better understand over time through that data what kind of outcomes people are experiencing. Where care transcends across the between NHS and if you like, the private facilities, it becomes sometimes a little bit more difficult to obtain that data and to be able to use it in a way that allows that proper understanding and that. But as I say, I think the point that you make is still critical, in that we rely on the use of that data to be able to understand the outcomes that are associated with it. And as I say, some of the new processes, protocols, as you described, that will come into play will allow us to do that an awful lot better in the future.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I just wanted to follow up on a particular incident that was mentioned earlier on in one of the submissions by a patient, that the Scottish Complex Complex Mesh Surgical Service only accepts gynaecological referrals. Just wanted to ask why patients wishing to have other types of surgical mesh removed couldn't utilise that service, and why it's restricted in that way.
Mr. O'Kelly might want to add more to this, but that service has clearly been set up with surgeons whose focus of training just now has been on the urogynecological use of mesh, and because that is so highly specialised and specific, then perhaps it wouldn't be appropriate for them to be looking at the use of that in other sites as well. It's very site-specific, but Mr. O'Kelly might want to add more.
Gregor, the centre was set up specifically for the purpose of complex complications from urogynecological mesh. There is a multidisciplinary team which consists of urogynecologists, urologists and colorectal surgeons, and I think over time the group, if not yet, will take on the burden of rectopexy mesh, which is very specialised, and it sort of crosses the boundary between urogynecology and colorectal surgery, the interface between the last part of the large bowel and the gynecological structures, gyna. And I know in England that is certainly the way that the management will proceed. With regard to other meshes, the stentor just it's not been constructed for that. For sure, I think that the clinicians are available to be consulted, but it is not, they're not really taking referrals as such from or non pelvic gynecological mesh as described. And I think that's actually appropriate for that particular stentor as it is.
The final area, just to touch on, you alluded to in your opening statement, Minister, is the evidence we received and the subsequent oral testimony we had with Dr. Spencer Netto from Shoulders Hospital in Canada. And David Torrance is going to lead some questions here. Thank you, David.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, Sir Gregor Smith and Kerry O'Kelly. In evidence from Dr. Spencer Netto from the Shoulders Hospital in Canada, he highlighted how successful they were with natural tissue repairs and the low reoccurrence in hernias. So can I ask, how does preoperative preparation and post-operative care for hernia repair surgery in Scotland differ from those undertaken in Shoulders Hospital?
So I think it's probably worth going to Mr. O'Kelly on this question, but as I understand it, that's a very specialised unit and patients are somewhat pre-selected. So it isn't a population that would be reflective of the general population seeking surgery in Scotland. That aside, the results are very impressive, and it's not, you know, we are very interested in the work that they're doing over in Canada. But as I understand it, if you were to compare the population that use that unit in Canada with the population seeking hernia repair in Scotland, there might be significant differences, for example, in terms of obesity or ambulation or things like that. But I'll hand over to Dr. O'Kelly, who'll be able to give you a better explanation.
Yeah, I think the Shoulder-Ice results and their outcomes are very impressive. But I think they make the point that the relative contraindications and relative risks with regards to successive surgery are smoking, obesity, diabetes, some other pre-existing conditions, the quality of the underlying structures, and also the size of the defect. Now, I think some of those aspects are going to question that Mr. Torrance asked, we don't have a great deal of control over, but I think that in the build-up for surgery, I think prehabilitation, I think which you might be alluding to, I think that could play a very significant role in getting patients fitter for surgery, trying to get them to stop smoking, increasing their exercise levels if they can, losing some weight, reducing alcohol, etc. I think that is all something that is all things which are going to be beneficial for patients and which we are looking to promote. And I think that if then surgery is conducted in a get it right first time manner, then patients are in good shape and will be able to not only benefit from that surgery, but benefit from that surgery at an earlier stage with post-operative mobilisation, return to normal activities. But I think that there are lessons to be learned from Shoulder-Ice. Things that we can apply to try and improve the lot of patients having surgery in this country.
Kelly, there's very strict criteria at Shoulder-Ice Hospital, and especially around weight loss. And in fact, they actually quoted Dr. Spencer Nettle that up to some of their patients could lose between 50 and 100 pounds before they will even see them and go ahead with that natural repair. Could that criteria be brought into play here, or would it be acceptable to put that criteria on a repair here?
Well, I think denying it is very difficult, isn't it? Because are we going to deny patients access to surgery if we believe they're overweight? And I think that would be the subject for, I suspect, parliamentary debate. The other issue really is, what is the problem that the hernia is causing? Is it, have they got strangulated hernia? Do we need to engage in life-saving surgery? Is this preventing them working? We also know that trying to get to patients when they are of a certain size, losing weight becomes almost impossible without some other medical intervention. And particularly that would be the case if they're diabetic. I think they are, these are ethical issues, which are profound I think worthy of consideration, but perhaps you have an opinion as well on that, which might be probably better than my own, I think.
David Torrance?
Sir Gregor.
Yeah.
You look quite I think
I think you've raised a really interesting ethical dilemma there, haven't you? And I know that's one that many clinicians would feel uncomfortable with. I feel uncomfortable with it, even talking about it just now. But the restriction of access to treatment because of personal criteria is something which many clinicians, as I say, feel deeply, deeply uncomfortable with, particularly when there's a health need that lies at the bottom of it. However, if you turn round this concept a little bit and look at the education that we can work with patients in relation to the concept of risk, I think you then begin to explore an area where there's mutual benefit. And it's about trying to be able to encapsulate the risk of certain personal characteristics for people before they enter all sorts of treatment, where risk is increased because of the personal characteristics that they experience. And then using education, working with patients to that term prehabilitation that is becoming more familiar to us all, so that they are able to prepare themselves for surgery in a way that helps to reduce that risk. That's part of the conversation that we spoke about earlier when we spoke about the benefits, the risks, the alternatives, what happens if I do nothing. And we know that there's many approaches that we can take with patients to discuss that and work with them. You know, the two most obvious ones are simply about you know, weight loss before surgery is a good thing if you are overweight. It doesn't matter what type of surgery you're undergoing. If you are more obese, there are greater risks that are associated with surgery and general anaesthesia as a consequence of that. And we know that specifically with abdominal surgeries, such as kind of hernia repairs, again, being more obese is associated with slightly poorer outcomes there. Smoking, similarly. So, you know, knowing those characteristics, you can then describe risk in different terms to those individuals. You can begin to calibrate risk for them so that they will have their own tolerance to risk and are then able to judge, well, you know, if I'm going to go forward and have this treatment that I think that, you know, I really want to have and need to have, then these are the things that I can do, my personal responsibility to contribute to better outcomes there. But I think many people would feel very, very uncomfortable about restrictive methods to access surgery when people are particularly experiencing a lot of discomfort.
Thank you for that. Are the skills in natural tissue hernia repair techniques being lost in Scotland in favour of teaching surgeons mesh repairs? And could more surgeons in Scotland be receiving training in natural tissue methods?
Mr. O'Kelly will want to come in on this, but there, as I understand it, there is real interest in improving the expertise within Scotland in natural tissue repair, and they're looking at centres which use those techniques in Europe just because of the ease and practicalities of links with Europe versus links with North America. But I'll let Mr. O'Kelly tell you a little bit more about that.
There's a passage in the or section in the Shoulders report that you obtained from clinic that described mesh surgical training, and it was easier to do, and that's the reason why it was practiced. That aspect of training was germane to surgical training in Scotland. I think that's a bit disingenuous. I think there's been an emphasis on mesh training and mesh surgery because of its efficacy, as proven and as revealed in the Scottish Health Technologies Group report. We do, I think, having said that, need to offer patients choice. That's really important. And there'll be some for whom mesh is not appropriate. And it is, I think, critical that with each health board, patients have access to non-mesh surgery when it's appropriate. And that may be within the health board, it may be it somewhere else in Scotland. I can't tell you how many surgeons we would need to train, but I think it's going to be more than one. And I think that one of the discussions we will have with the Scottish Associated Medical Directors when we meet with them is around a provision of a training and access to training for colleagues who wish to do this. In my own health board, one of my colleagues is keen to take this forward. And has started to make contacts, and actually will probably travel with one of the surgeons from NHS Lothian. But I think one person in my board is not going to be sufficient. We need at least two people. So it's going to depend a bit on demand. It's also, I think, important that the individual surgeons, that they're not practicing one procedure per year. They've got to have a volume, and it may to be effective and efficient. I think that colleagues will need to buddy up, certainly at the start, make sure that the numbers are correct and that they are refreshing their skills through practice. And that one of the successes of Shoulder Ice is that the surgeons there are performing 600 or 700 procedures per year. So that's if 15-20 procedures per week, taking into account leave and one thing or another, because they're doing the same thing every day. And you become very proficient, I'm sure. And that's something that we also need to
showed this example demonstrates the success of a specialised hernia repair unit. Is that possible to have a centre like that in Scotland, taking into account the criteria that is needed to have that success rate?
So that certainly, I can understand why you would ask that. I mean, if I think back to some of the debates in my own constituency, there's a real tension between accessing healthcare as close to home as possible, but being able to access national expertise when required. And I get many more concerns from constituents who are having to travel, even within the constituency, in order to access care than I hear appeals to be able to travel for specialist expertise. I think the way that we tend to work in NHS Scotland is that for routine care, you should be able to access it as close to home as possible. And I think there's lots of good reasons for that. If you think about the, you know, rather than just the medical model of health, but think about the biopsychosocial, it's really important that people are close to home and have the support around them and are able to recover well within their families, within their communities for this type of procedure. If you think about the particular challenging or complex procedures, we need to build an expertise, and we are going to have to work in a networked way across Scotland, I think, to deliver that. And we've, you know, said that there are challenges with volume. If people are going to train in natural tissue repair, then they're going to have to be seeing enough people to maintain that training. So we will certainly consider about what is the best model for Scotland, but I'm not right at this moment minded to reconstruct the unit in Canada here in Scotland. I'll hand over to Mr. O'Kelly, who's keen to come in.
We are quite short of time. It's a couple of questions to come.
Just say, with the creation of the national network of treatment diagnostic centres, there will be some migration of patients in their locale to these facilities. And I think that will give the opportunity to concentrate colleagues who have particular expertise and interest in these fields. And it may be, as careers develop, that they will choose perhaps to have a more scheduled workload rather than the unscheduled care. And that would actually, if they're doing more hernia lists, actually increase numbers and move much more towards a shoulder ice time model. But I'm not sure for most of our colleagues that is a very attractive way of, for their professional life to do just one thing all the time.
Okay, thank you. We are very short of time. I'm very grateful for the time you've given us. Perhaps in just any final remarks you might want to make, I'll just invite Alexander Stewart and Paul Sweeney, both had supplementaries, if they would just like to ask them, and then you could maybe round up just in any final comment, a response to either of them. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. You've touched on the necessity to try and create facilities that will support individuals. And you know, Canada gave us a very good example of what was being achieved. And I appreciate that you want to try and ensure that medical support is given to individuals at the closest point. But there still may require to be some need for specialisation, because by doing that, it then maybe creates a unit or a expertise within the field for individuals and clinicians themselves to do that. And I do think that is something that should be considered in the way going forward, Minister, because that may help to iron out some of the difficulties that we've seen, and it would be good to get your views on that.
And Paul Sweeney?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think it was just to build on the point about the Scottish Complex Mesh Surgical Service being perhaps the opportunity to evolve this into a model where, given such a small volume of defects in the national population base, combined with Scotland's relatively small geography and population base, the idea of concentration to deal with complex defects and rectification of defects is a way of actually potentially building a service that could build in some of the examples that Dr. Netto sort of appealed for as the kind of key takeaway of building that national centre. Whilst not saying that everybody has to go and get a surgical repair of a hernia done, in a national centre in Glasgow or somewhere, if you're living in Lerwick. you know, but if there are complex cases or high risk cases, then maybe that is the most appropriate solution. Would you agree that that's maybe where we need to look at?
Certainly. I mean, I think they're two separate things. The shoulder centre is dealing with more routine operations, quite high volume, and it's in terms of giving people options of a highly skilled and highly trained surgeons who are using those techniques. And I think that's probably something we need to explore on a national basis, but we can build up local expertise. I agree there does need to be perhaps a national multidisciplinary team that look at these particularly complex cases, and certainly clinicians need to be able to access that expertise all over the country. It should be, you know, it is difficult to understand how challenging it can be to communicate cross boundaries within the NHS, and it's a theme that comes up time and time again, and we are very keen to bust those boundaries to make sure that people can, clinicians can access the expertise that they require for their patients wherever they live in the country, and we are very mindful about how to develop systems that mean that patients wherever they live in the country can access the right level of expertise. And we know that, I mean, actually people in Lerwick are probably more comfortable with travelling than people on the mainland. They travel all the time. So patient choice needs to be part of this as well. I go back to, again, and these need to be decisions, shared decisions that are made with patients about what is the best option for them.
Final thought from Sir Gregor and then from Mr. O'Kelly.
Yeah, I mean, I just want to emphasise again, even if you look at the extant clinical strategy for the country, one of the concepts that was explored within that clinical strategy is the tension that exists between competency for any given procedure or approach to care and the volume of patients likely to be seen. And the recognition that sometimes is that we need to look at ways where nationally we can provide a way of providing care for those low volume type procedures. I think that's something that all clinicians would certainly sign up to. There's different ways of achieving that. And I think Mr. O'Kelly has spoken about the informal and formal networks that develop around about care that can provide that highly specialised approach when it's required. That is something which we see underpins much of our clinical strategy. And occasionally there's a need to develop that further to centres of excellence where you have a much more formalised structure and team which is approached to there. And it's gauging which is going to be the best method of providing the support to these people when they need it.
Finally, Mr. O'Kelly.
Well made, and I think it would be something that I think Gregor, we discussed, and actually take forward to the medical directors. You know, how can we ensure that the best opinions, the best skills are applied when they're required on all occasions? And that does mean engagement through the board networks. And it's how do we improve liaison and allow that sort of cross-fertilisation of ideas and.
Thank all three of you very much. Just in conclusion, I don't know if you saw any of our evidence with Shoulders Hospital, but Dr. Spencer Netto, I understand the geography is involved in it all, but in principle, he was very happy to facilitate any access to the expertise that they've developed with their clinicians there to the benefit of the Scotland's NHS, were that thought to be useful, and they'd be very happy to explore that further if the opportunity or the offer was one that the Scottish Government felt it wanted to pursue. But can I thank all of you very much for your evidence this morning and temporarily suspend this part of the meeting. Thank you. back. And members, can I just confirm that we're content to consider the evidence we heard in relation to the previous petition at a future meeting? We are. Thank you. We are now bringing together four petitions that we've been considering into one evidence session. And those four petitions are petition number 1845, an agency to advocate for the healthcare needs of rural Scotland, lodged by Gordon Baird. 1890, which is to find solutions to recruitment and training challenges for rural healthcare in Scotland, with Maria Aiken on behalf of the Caithness Health Action Team. Petition 1915, to reinstate Caithness Community Council and Caithness NHS Board, lodged by Billy Sinclair. And finally, petition number 1924, to complete an emergency in-depth review of women's health services in Caithness and Sutherland with Rebecca Wymer. Maria Aiken and Rebecca Wymer, good morning to you, are joining us as we consider this petition. And we have Gordon Baird, I believe, and Billy Sinclair with us. I'm just, my eyesight, these things are very helpful if you've got good eyesight. They're not so helpful from a distance, but good to understand that who you both are. Both, welcome to you all. We also have a number of interested colleagues from the Scottish Parliament who are with us in relation to this. We welcome Rhoda Grant, which is, I do at every meeting. it's nice to have you with us again, Rhoda. Emma Harper, MSP, and Colin Smith, MSP, both from with rural healthcare interests in their constituencies. And we'll return to our parliamentary colleagues when we've heard from our petitioners, as I know you're keen to speak in favour of the petitions. Members will have a number of questions they would like to explore this morning. So if the panel is happy, I think we're going to move to the first of those. And I should explain to our petitioners joining us virtually that if you would like to come in at any point, I can see you both on the screen in front of me. So you can either put an R in the chat box, or if you put up your hand, I think we're probably going to see that as well. And I'd be very happy to bring you in at that point. For our petitioners in the room, if you again can catch my eye or one of the clerks, they'll make sure that I know that you're keen to intervene on one of the questions. I should also say there's absolutely no obligation for you to feel that you've got to jump in and ask questions. You may just be content to hear the evidence that is coming in to understand how we proceed. We're now going to move to questions, and I'm going to invite Fergus Ewing to lead the questioning off in relation to this petition. Mr. Ewing.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to all our witnesses. Could I just begin by saying I'm very grateful that collectively you've brought the issues of health in rural Scotland to Parliament. I think they're very important ones. Could I start off by posing questions to Mr. Baird in respect of your petition, which urges the Scottish Government to create an agency to ensure that health boards offer fair and reasonable management of rural and remote healthcare issues. And I'm sure you're familiar with the broad arrangements in Scotland, whereby there are 14 regional NHS boards. There are, and there have been since around 2014, 31 integration authorities. And more recently, in 2020, the Remote and Rural General Practice Working Group published its report called Shaping the Future Together, and the Scottish Government accepted all the recommendations in this report, including, and I think this is perhaps one of the most relevant ones, a commitment to develop a national centre for remote and rural healthcare for Scotland. So I'm mentioning that because I think it's an important sort of backdrop. And just following on that, Mr. Baird, I wonder if I could ask two questions to you, and I'll just put them both. Firstly, how could the Scottish Government reform the way in which the NHS and social care is currently organised better to address the needs of remote and rural constituents, populations? And secondly, will the development of this National Centre for Remote and Rural Healthcare for Scotland help address some of the issues raised in your petition?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. the first thing is that the current structures are very effective in delivering healthcare to many aspects of clinical care. The problem is the inequities that occur because of access. In the past, that's been dealt with by an advocacy process, primarily through general practice. And in the 1980s, Richard Smith, editor of the BMJ, wrote that Dumfries and Galloway, where the NHS works well, and he wrote, most of the doctors in the region know the senior administrators and can find their ear without difficulty, so much so that one doctor suggested that the advisory committees were redundant. In short, the ability to represent local issues was embedded in the system through a system of mutual respect and a process of advocacy. In 1989, he followed this up in the BMJ. He's editor of the BMJ and wrote specific articles about this. It was to flourish or fade. And at that point, 10 years later, he described an institutional view of Wigtonshire as the Wild West. And by 1999, the Dumfries and Galloway Health Board was straining but optimistic. So this is a long-standing issue. The current structures alone fail rural patients. As Paul Sweeney said to this committee, the elephant in the room is the role of NHS health boards, who are meant to be the democratic voice for stakeholders in the regions and who are clearly not performing that role effectively. And there needs to be consideration of how effective these health boards are at representing the interests of these areas. So what I think that we need is to alter the capacity of rural clinicians to influence management thinking, far less further creating change. And instead of mutual respect, there's antagonism and rancour, which we have to deal with. And best evidence is gaslighted and stonewalled. So all of that is currently within the system, and the boards are not particularly accountable. And that's true throughout Scotland. I think Keith Ness will find the same. So our view is that an independent advocacy, such as the Commissioner's Health in Australia and Children and Young People in Scotland, have proven invaluable. And they've got to be separate of providers' structures. So that needs to be completely independent. There are other names for similar agencies, but broadly speaking, we need an agency advocacy role embedded in healthcare management and externally imposed. In terms of the National Centre, being a centre, I cannot argue against the National Centre for Rural Health. I think it's a good thing, but it strikes me that it's likely to have a significant provider role, and that provider role is a barrier to it being an advocacy process. Secondly, it's only central, generally speaking, in Inverness or Aberdeen, if you're near Inverness and Aberdeen. So every time I hear centre as a GP of 40 years' experience, I rather cringe and think, here we go again. This needs to be about local engagement and advocacy from the bottom up, rather than a centre, which is yet another silo, as described in the Sturrock report. So I think the National Centre will be very useful, and I cannot argue against it, but I don't think it provides the advocacy that we're proposing. And furthermore, the advocacy that we propose will help the National Centre to deal with the issues that it faces. I'm sorry I've taken so long.
Thank you for your answer, and you covered a lot of territory. I wonder if I might just pursue some of the points. I mean, your petition calls for an agency, and that presumably means one agency, if I've understood it. How is one agency going to deliver the kind of advocacy that would be required from bottom up? And, you know, given that what you're suggesting, as I understand it, is not an agency to deliver or procure service provision, but to advocate that it be provided to people living in remote and rural areas more effectively, and that inequities of access are therefore addressed and not ignored, stonewalled or gaslighted. If that is the case, and I'm just putting this to you as a sort of devil's advocate, I suppose, would it not be more efficacious for achieving what you wish to achieve that there be an advocate for the rural voice on each board? Would that not be a different way, perhaps, rather than the establishment of one centrally based agency, presumably, or wherever it's based, it would have to be based somewhere. Would an alternative model not to change the way health boards operate so that they would include an advocate amongst their number with a specific remit to make sure that remote and rural issues are not overlooked and are addressed? So I'm just putting that to you as, and indeed other petitioners, because you're all covering interlocking aspects of this. Would that not be a better model, perhaps, than one agency, which inevitably would operate on, you know, a high level?
Mr. Baird, and if any of our other petitioners might want to comment on this, then be sure to let me know. Mr. Baird?
Well, thank you. Yes, I've considered that possibility, but the thing is that various rural areas have got the same issues. For example, we've got in Dumfries and Galloway a lot of deprivation, the worst 1% in Scotland, the worst 1% for cancer access in Scotland, and probably at present the worst community maternity care provision in the UK. So there are other areas such as Caithness that have it, and throughout Scotland. And the problem is that if you fragment it, the problem has always been with rural and remote, and I was chair of the Royal College of GPs Rural and Remote Practice Subgroup. The problem with rural and remote is that it's disparate, and that it's rarely seen as an holistic thing. Now, the interesting thing is that NHS England Professor Sir Chris Whitty, not having much to pass the time with in 2021, chose to look at NHS England's priority as health in coastal communities. So it's a big health issue. And if you join up, the strength is, first of all, strength in numbers, that it becomes a big problem that government and boards cannot ignore. Secondly, you can develop shared solutions and you can create a better understanding of where the solutions lie. So it's about sharing of information and sharing of solutions and gathering information and data. For the last 30 years, I've been providing data to try and persuade our health board as an advocacy role, both when I was working and when I was retired, that we don't belong in the east of Scotland, we're 40 miles west of Glasgow. I've been profoundly unsuccessful. So a specific advocacy, taking a national view, would help in that regard. In terms of being on a board, I was concerned about some local issues and tried to contact the whistleblowing champion on our board, and the response is, it isn't appropriate for me to meet with your group at this stage. Now, between our group, we have 100 years of experience in the NHS and public service. And that is not the fault of the board member particularly, it's the fault of the system. But the whistleblowing champion was set up in response to the Sturrock report. And what I would like to see is that there is some national oversight of this going, and that's much more easily achieved by a national committee.
To follow that, I didn't quite understand why you didn't find acceptable the suggestion, which you say you'd already considered anyway, that each board should have a member whose role would be thus. Why do you not want that? I would have thought that may not be all the solution, but it might be a part of the solution.
I think that summed up the government the government decided there should be a whistleblowing champion on each board following the Sturrock report. And the whistleblowing, so, and we're the advocates, we're trying to provide advocacy for our patients. And the whistleblowing champion said, it isn't appropriate for me to meet with your group. So, well, so it doesn't, it doesn't work.
Okay. Right. You said that, I think you said that you were, I don't think you said that you welcomed the National Centre for Remote and Rural Healthcare, but I think you did, or perhaps you did, but you said it was a sort of step in the right direction. Could I ask you, would this new body, when it's set up, could it be set up in such a way that its remit, and we can raise this with the Scottish Government following this meeting, perhaps, if this is something that you and your colleagues think would be a good idea, we could perhaps seek views from the Scottish Government as to whether the National Centre for Remote and Rural Healthcare should have the specific remit of taking up the issues that Dr. Baird, you have raised today. Would that be something that would be a step forward?
Well, I think it would be a step forward, and I think a National Centre for Rural Healthcare is a good thing. Whether it would solve these issues, I have concerns about. For example, I did quite a lot of work with NESS before I retired, and it was commonplace during visits or telephone conferences to be asked what was the weather like in Dumfries. Now, those are people who were embedded in rural healthcare with NESS, and they didn't even know that not only is Dumfries far away, it's not even in the next county. So I guess I have concerns about a lack of focus in such a wide-ranging view. We're talking specifically about access, clinical access issues.
I guess what I'm putting to you is that this new body could be tasked specifically in law with the remit of addressing the access issues that you have raised. Excellent. And were that to be the case, then you know, it may not operate perfectly in practice, but if all one can do in setting up new bodies is to clearly define the remit and the duties of these new bodies and the tasks that they perform, surely if they're tasked to perform what you want them to perform, namely addressing inequities of access for people who live in remote and rural Scotland, then that would at least give the opportunity for things to improve.
We've already got those bodies. They're called health boards. The problem is that they're not listening to the rural and remote issues.
Well, could I ask, I mean, I think David Johnson's keen to ask a sort of supplementary in relation to this, which maybe some of our other witnesses might feel they could comment on too.
Thank you, Convener. What do you think are the current issues impacting on recruitment of the health and social care staff in rural areas? To all the...
Yes, Maria Aiken.
Hi, good morning. We raised this petition following a meeting with our local midwifery team, who discussed the worries about not being able to recruit midwives within the Caithness area, and their disappointment and the impact of the shortened midwifery course that was being delivered at the time from the University of the Highlands and Islands. And that was then centralised to Edinburgh, and the Scottish Government withdrew the funding for this course. So my petition has actually about two aspects. The first is the need for rural communities to be able to access local training for professional healthcare qualifications and to gain the skills locally whenever possible. The second aspect, what I'm going to raise as well, is the need for an agency or an overseer to ensure that rural communities are not disadvantaged and are given equity in training for qualifications. You know, one lesson that we learned from the COVID pandemic is that distance should not now be a barrier to access training, and that technology can be effectively used to ensure inclusion and accessibility for remote and rural communities. and that our students should not have to travel hundreds of miles from their homes to access the training. And they should not have to take on large student loans to pay for accommodation to access a university. And they should have a choice to suit their life circumstances. And it's really important for inclusion and also for the sustainability of our communities, as the research suggests that where a student trains is often where they continue to stay. So higher education providers should provide inclusive distance learning methods to support rural education and recruitment using technology to enable the remote learning. And they should provide the clinical skills whenever possible locally. So that's the main issues. And I would bring up, you know, that we have worked with health boards, you know, for a number of years after our maternity model was downgraded. And we have found to be health boards, they're not accessible to the public, for one thing. And we have found them, basically, we have experienced a lot of what has been raised in the historic report from the health boards, you know. And if someone was to be on the health board to represent our needs and to be our voice for rural and remote communities, it would need to be an independent person, because they would need to be very strong to have that voice to support our areas, our remote and rural communities, which would be quite difficult to do in a very big health board.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Sinclair.
I'm afraid what we know at the moment with NHS Highland is it does not work for the rural areas. It does not work at all. We know what works because we had it before. And Orkney has this now as well. And we would love Caithness to be put back into what we would call the Orkney model, or what Caithness had before the NHS Highland took over. Because at the moment, well, I have a wee prepared thing here. Can I go through this?
Yes, I did.
Right, prior to 1995, Caithness was in control of its own council and National Health Service. There was a shared consultancy-led maternity services in the town of Wick and Thurzel, and a first-class general surgeon in the Wick Hospital. So other than for highly specialised treatment, there was very little requirement for patients to travel out of the county to access National Health Service. Caithness had its own council, so it controlled over the budget and could make sure the money was spent where it was needed. Over a period of 6 years, Caithness lost all control over its council and health services when the Highland Council and NHS Highland came into being, both based at Inverness. From that point on, at a local level, there's been a deterioration in the services provided in Caithness by both these agencies. The bullying culture that exists in NHS Highland is well documented in the historic report. And unfortunately, Caithness has been at the sharp end of this culture for years. Prior to removing our consultancy-led maternity service, there was a public meeting which NHS Highland attended. Unfortunately, they did not listen and the concerns expressed were ignored, and they went ahead and removed the service anyway. NHS Highland stated there was no clinical objection to the downgrading. This is untrue, but typical of NHS Highland's culture at this time. NHS Highland did not even listen to their own staff, one who said, and I quote, "The geographical distance and transfer times between Caithness and Regmore is greater than that accepted for a primary birthing unit, and that Regmore is absolutely not suited to the additional workload generated by these proposed changes." The consequence of these changes to a midwife-led unit had an enormous impact on Caithness mothers and babies, and eventually resulted in babies' deaths. After the babies' deaths, a report was commissioned entitled Caithness Maternity and Neonatal Services, a Public Health Review, published in 2016. One of the findings was that the babies died due to suboptimal care. Now, not being the smartest cookie in the jar, I had to look up what suboptimal care meant. And it means care not up to standard. It was also stated that Caithness as an area is socio-economically deprived. So this is what NHS Highland left us with when, as they say, they redesigned the service. What a damning indictment on NHS Highland. And then as a side, no one was held accountable. One of the recommendations made in the report was that first-time expectant mothers should travel the 120 miles to give birth at Regmore Hospital at Inverness. The report completely ignored the risk to mothers and babies travelling this distance. It also stipulated that no caesarean operations should be carried out at Caithness General. So if someone requires an emergent caesarean, what happens? The people of Caithness are desperate for this situation to be changed before we have another fatality. We had a close...
in there, because right. I mean, I think in response to all our questions, your solution is going to be the reinstatement of that entity, yes. Which is maybe not developing our discussion just quite in the way that might be helpful as well. Rebecca Wymer, I know you were keen to come in response to the question David Torrance put.
Hi, good morning. Yeah, I do agree with quite a lot of the previous petitioner, but just going back to the recruitment issues. For those of you on Twitter, and I am new to Twitter, I know it's not, you know, the most political damning evidence. Hamza Yousaf actually posted yesterday that the NHS staffing levels are now at a record high in Scotland. But the argument I had back from him a few months ago saying that recruitment was almost impossible for the area has either done an enormous U-turn, or it's that lots and lots of staffing is happening very, very centrally and not in a rural capacity. From what I have heard from people over the last year, campaigning and talking to people, is that when the maternity unit was downgraded, we also saw the loss of the gynaecology department, because obs and gyne are so linked. Our gynaecological services have ticked away centrally, and now we have hardly anything. We don't have an emergency gynaecologist, which means we have no emergency women's healthcare. It's potluck if you get a junior doctor who's done a rotation on gynaecology. That's about as good as it gets at the moment. So I have had lots of people who've said to me that they have been put off moving up for professional positions, despite the fact they've been very well qualified, 10 years in a surgical position, but they will not move up here because themselves or their families cannot access women's healthcare or maternity to the standard that they are used to and that they should expect. If they used to live in Scotland, and they still live in Scotland, they should have the same quality of care, no matter the postcode. I do think that Hamza Yousaf's boast on Twitter is either poorly timed or slightly out of touch. I am looking forward to meeting him in person when he comes up in the summer to discuss it further. But time and time again, we have seen people either move away from professional positions to seek better healthcare or not move up because they can't access the healthcare that they should have to. So that maybe sheds a tiny bit of light as to why these positions are not being filled. And that goes for lots of sectors. Hospitality is struggling. You know, the nuclear industry sometimes lose very good members of staff because they simply won't risk a pregnancy, or somebody has a condition like endometriosis or PCOS, like myself, and we can't access the emergency care that we need.
Emma Harper, I know you've been listening to this and been quite keen to come in specifically on some of the just themes that have been developing. I'm very happy to involve you at this point.
Great, thanks. Good morning, convener. Rather than make any statements, I think I'll ask Dr. Gordon Baird a question that might help look at how an agency to advocate for patients might be something we should consider. If we had board members that were part of each health board that were focusing on rural, I think that might be something that would see them then become embedded in the culture of that health board and not actually have a voice to advocate. So an independent agency is something that I would support. But I'm interested to pursue what you said, Gordon, about the rancour or the confrontational issues. Or when I try and represent constituents in Dumfries and Galloway on health issues, it seems to be perceived as confrontational, and that's the last thing we need when we're trying to pursue best healthcare support as we're emerging out of the pandemic. So I would be interested to hear from you, Gordon, about how an agency that can advocate would help reduce the perceived confrontation that MSPs have, or anybody who's not engaging with a whistleblower, or how would an agency help support that?
I think the Sturrock report was excellent, and it gave a clue as to the way forward, and it talks continually about mediation. And I think local people inevitably have focused local issues, and that's not always the best way to deal with things. What I've tried to do over the last decades is to use science to support the argument, and reasoned, rational and clinical arguments. And that's not always popular. The solution that I would offer to Keith Ness, if I were King, might not be acceptable. But I hope it would be based on best evidence and shared good practice and be equitable throughout the area. That's not happening. In terms of being independent as opposed to part of a national centre, I think that needs to be thought through very carefully. A national centre will almost certainly be a provider unit. It will be providing education, it will be providing services. And you really wouldn't get Ofgem run by SSE. You know, it's not going to happen. The provider and the purchaser must be separate. Now, in the 1980s, before the purchaser-provider split, going back to recruitment, I advertised for a job as partner in my practice. I got 80 applicants. One in the Lake District got 220 applicants. Now, we were able to, as Richard Smith said in the BMJ, we were able to advocate for our patients. We knew that when we went to somebody on the health board, and he mentions that connection between the health board and doctors, both the executive and non-executive, rural doctors, that is. That worked. That worked really well. Now, we'll be very lucky in a rural and remote area if you get an applicant at all. A commissioner would take over that advocacy role, but he or she would have to be independent and not part of one of the embedded structures within the political and managerial system. That's my view, but it's based on my experience and my research in the literature and my time as chair of the college committee.
Do you want to follow up on that point?
Yep. I mean, I am one of the challenges that I've had, and I know my colleagues have had, Finlay Carson and Colin Smith, is that, like, the South East Cancer Network is where Dumfries and Galloway is part of, when nowhere in Dumfries and Galloway is in the east of Scotland. So the challenges are trying to, okay, look at that, engage. Health board said it's up to the government. Government says it's up to the health board. We don't want to dictate how cancer care is done, but we need people to have a choice of whether their radiotherapy is given in Edinburgh, which might be better, or Glasgow. So that's only one of the examples that 260-mile round-trip journey for folk feast and rar are not given a choice about, or we're told they're given a choice, but we don't really have the evidence and the feedback about it. So an advocacy agency, or however it's chosen to be run, whether it's a commissioner, whether it's an agency, is something that I'm interested in pursuing, so that we can look at the real challenges in rural healthcare. Our health committee is doing a health inequalities inquiry right now, and many of these issues are coming to light. So I'm hearing from the other petitioners as well that there are challenges for remote and rural, that whether it's Keith Ness, whether it's Galloway, whether it's the Borders, that it would be great to have some ability to join up all the work that's been done and see how it can be taken forward to specifically address the needs that we're seeing of our people. So And I'll stop there. Thank you.
I think we've got two other parliamentary colleagues with us as well, and they've been listening to the petitioners who've all now spoken. And I wonder whether either of you would like to just contribute at this point. Rhoda Grant?
Yes. I mean, I think the petitioners have made very clear what the issues are. There is a huge distance to travel to access healthcare, and they're not being heard. Now, just as an example, with regard to maternity services in Caithness, I've been asking the health board for a risk assessment of the journey between Caithness and Inverness when people go into labour early, for example. I know people are more likely to be induced or have elective caesareans, but it does occur that people go into labour and need to drive down that road. Now, that road is horrendous in the winter. It can often be blocked. To have somebody, and we were discussing this before the committee, to have somebody drive their partner down that road when their partner is in labour, given it's an offence to use your phone in a car while driving, can you imagine what it's like to have someone in active labour beside you while you're trying to concentrate on a really difficult, dangerous road? Nobody will risk assess, and this is the same for Murray, I've asked the same questions, nobody will risk assess the journey and what happens there. And I think, you know, I would hope the committee would at least request that in emergency situations where there's not local health care, where is the risk of transporting people? And certainly at the start, when this happened in Caithness, there wasn't enough ambulance cover. If there was someone being transported by an ambulance, quite often the county was left without an ambulance at all. Now, that has been resolved to an extent, but it's still not ideal. So just to add my support to the petitioners, that it's really not equitable, the health care that they receive.
Colin Smith.
Thank you very much, Convener. My interest is obviously primarily in the petition from Dr Baird, who's a constituent of mine, but I think what Dr Baird is actually proposing is an issue that's pertinent to all the petitioners that we're discussing today, in particular that common theme of the inadequate health provision in rural areas, and the very fact that no one appears to be advocating on behalf of those communities, and those communities are not being listened to. I think Emma Harper highlighted the example of cancer care in Dumfries and Galloway, where constituents of ours in Stranraer have to travel to Edinburgh for cancer care treatment when there's a hospital in Glasgow able to provide that, and nobody is actually tackling that particular problem, either the health board or the Scottish Government. A number of ideas have been suggested in the discussion on how we can tackle that, particularly from Mr Ewan. The suggestion was that we should have somebody on the health board with a particular rural interest. I would hope that when people are appointed to a health board like Dumfries and Galloway, they do have a knowledge of rural health care. So reinforcing that wouldn't do any harm, but it fails to recognise that what we have is a Scotland-wide problem when it comes to rural health care, that there will be commonality between the challenges in Caithness and the challenges in Dumfries and Galloway, and there will be solutions to that need to be Scotland-wide. The problem is often the health board, but it isn't exclusively the health board when it comes to finding that particular solution. It was also suggested that maybe the National Centre for Remote and Rural Healthcare could have an advocacy role. Again, my understanding is that that's primarily a delivery mechanism, and also, crucially, I think, it's part of the NHS. It's not independent. It was interesting that yesterday the government announced that they now supported an independent food commission and rejected the idea that Food Standards Scotland could take on that role. They did that presumably because it's independent of government, and I think that's a key point in this discussion. There is nobody independent with national authority advocating on behalf of rural communities when it comes to healthcare. We have a model in Australia where we do have a rural health commissioner, and I think that's a model that we should be looking at here in Scotland, and I see no harm in a piece of work being carried out on how do we strengthen advocacy for rural healthcare in Scotland, whether that's a commissioner or another model, because what's absolutely clear is the current setup is simply not working.
I thank our parliamentary colleagues just for those interventions at this stage, and keen to bring the petitioners back in. Rebecca Wymer, you're keen to contribute again.
Hi, yeah, just a quick one. So I just wanted to thank Rhoda for her input about the travel time, the distance and the quality of the roads. I actually asked Mr Yusuf about this in correspondence before and during the petition, not only do I have a business on the NC 500 route, so I can tell you exactly how busy it is winter and summer. The road is appalling in the winter. My dad's in the police for 11, 20 something years. And the amount of people that he pulled out of the roads and smashed cars, and that was before it became one of the busiest. It's the top 10 busiest roads and traffic journeys and routes in the world now. It's incredibly popular. And one of the worrying things that we're seeing more and more of is young groups of under 25s hiring sports cars in groups of 8, 9, 12, racing each other around this track. Now, the overtakes that they take, if they hit an oncoming ambulance, if there was somebody behind those vehicles trying to concentrate on the road, it's almost impossible to get from Inverness to Wick without some sort of near-miss accident. So just, I know that most of you have probably already been to the area or have a similar problem where you are. But for those of you who haven't, the one-way journey from Wick to Inverness, which is the most straightforward route, if you live in Sutherland, if you live in Betty Hill, in Thurlow, it's slightly longer. It's actually the same as from where you are sitting to Newcastle upon Tyne. And if you add it as a combined return journey, the mileage equates from where you're sitting to the city of York on far worse quality roads. Now, it wouldn't be acceptable for the vast majority of women in Edinburgh to travel on these roads on far better roads, for routine scans, appointments, clinics, labour, all miscarriages, even active miscarriages, past 12 weeks are expected to travel on those roads for upwards of 4 to 5 hours in the summer and 3 to 4 hours on awful conditions in the winter. So I spoke to Mr. Yusuf about this, and rather than taking into account the near misses and small accidents, which can still cause harm to patients in an emergency stop situation, he decided to focus on road closures. So he spoke to Traffic Scotland and came back with a bunch of statistics saying that the road was only ever closed for less than 4% of the year, 4% of the time over the last 4 years. The last 4 years includes 2 years where nobody could travel. So I don't think that those statistics are necessarily accurate. If it was rerun now, there would be a much more clear and accurate response. How often it is either closed on one side of the road, closed on both sides of the road, or there's a diversion that takes you on a very, very rural track where you can't get as fast, where you can't get to the hospital anywhere near as fast. I will leave it there. I have more to say on the travel situation, but I just wanted to back Roger up on the fact that it simply isn't safe. And I do think that an assessment of that journey has been skirted around for quite some time, and it does need to be looked into.
Thank you. I mean, your point on distances was well made, and characterising it in terms of a distance travelled from here, which is possibly more familiar to people than the one about which you're talking, was very well understood. Mr. Sinclair.
To follow up on what Rhoda Grant said about, again, about the distance and the hazard associated with travelling that distance. Just last year, a Wick lady started a journey in labour and had to stop at Golspie, 1 hour away from Inverness, and she gave birth to her first of her twins. She was then loaded back into the ambulance, put off to Regmore, where she had her second baby. It was a miracle that both mums and babies were well. There are another case of a lady giving birth in a lay-by, also near Golspie. This could happen again in present circumstances. What trauma these ladies suffered at what is supposed to be one of the happiest times of their lives. Is this really the best outcome for Caithness mums? What would members of the committee think if this was their wife, partner or daughter going through this?
And it's a while since Maria Aikens had an opportunity to contribute. Is there anything you'd like to say at this point before I bring in Paul Sweeney? Oh, I think we lost the link there. I'll maybe come back. Paul Sweeney.
I think there's been very compelling testimony, convener, around the democratic deficit around decision-making on health boards, and the tension that exists between the tendency for the medical profession to want to centralise into national centres and to sort of build their capacity versus the rights of rural patients to access services. And I think that's been borne out in discussions that we've had in a number of different petitions. So what I would want to ask the petitioners was around defining the rights of patients, regardless of where they are, and perhaps this vehicle, this advocacy body that's been proposed, is the best way of delivering that, that to define the right of a patient, whether it's in a gynecological context or any other context, to access services within a safe standard and a safe way. So the example you described in Caithness, for example, would be could be identified through data and study and inquiry as unsafe provision, and therefore the health board has an obligation to address that. And that could be placed on the health board as a obligation by this body to deal with it. Another alternative might be in instances where it is appropriate, for example, for neurosurgery, for example, to travel to Glasgow for an operation, that the patient has the right to have their travel costs covered and has the right to accommodation for a companion through the duration of that period of surgery and recovery, for example. You know, that's perhaps these are methods or mechanisms by which these things could be defined and therefore advocated for clearly. So maybe that is the mechanism by which this could be delivered, so by setting up such a national body where, stakeholders from different parts, different geographies can come together and define these standards that all patients, all citizens should be entitled to in different contexts and can take evidence from clinicians and patients, etc. Perhaps that is what we're all kind of driving towards. Would the petitioners agree that that's perhaps where this needs to arrive at? Thanks.
Well, just before we hear from Mr. Baird, I went to Maria Aiken. Unfortunately, we lost the link, but we're back with you now. So, Maria Aiken.
Thank you. Yeah, I would agree. I mean, at the time in 2016, when our maternity service was downgraded rapidly and without any consultation at all, we went to just about everyone to try and get help, and to have our voices heard. No one listened to us. We went to the Health Council. We went to, MSPs who did listen, but, actions aren't taken from what we're seeing. We're feeling that we're being forgotten and we're feeling that we're being ignored. We're disempowered in decisions that are made about our communities, because what tends to happen is these decisions are made in central areas of Scotland and with people that maybe haven't lived in a rural area and don't know the challenges and the barriers that we have. For example, most of our medical clinics and things are in Rigmore, which is a 200-mile journey. If we need to claim fuel costs, just now we get, I think it's gone up recently to 15 pence a mile. Now, when we were looking at the rates of subsidies that the Scottish Government give for attending these courses, it was 20 pence a mile to take your bike to Scottish Parliament. We are given 15 pence a mile to try and access our healthcare. A lot of people can't afford it. So, straight away you're disadvantaging, straight away you're deciding, am I going to have heat or food, or am I going to be able to access help with my healthcare? So, we need people that know about living in rural and remote areas, to make sure that we're being heard and to make sure that the decisions are made are based on, what's best for our communities. Just an example, so leaving on a positive note for recruitment, a really good example of obtaining a professional qualification is within the teaching profession in Scotland. You can study up to master's degree level, distance learning using technology. You don't have to leave your home. You don't have to leave your families or your communities. You can then progress for a year or 2 years part-time distance training for PGDE, and then have a paid year's teaching experience within your local area. Now, the Scottish Government have also set up, if you tick the Go Anywhere box, you can get £6,000 to teach in other areas, or it's £8,000 for secondary teaching posts. Now, I've spoken to a lot of teachers that live up here now who have done that, and they have come to the rural areas, love living here, and they're bringing up their families here. So it's a way to keep our communities sustainable and to encourage professionals to come up here and live. So it's things like that that need to be looked at, that, you know, when courses are set up to get professional qualifications, that independent person can say that could be done remotely. You know, the person doesn't have to attend a central university to get that professional qualification. Okay. And it removes people from poverty if they can get that professional qualification. I did it. I wouldn't have been able to get my teaching qualification because I had a family. I live up here. I couldn't leave them to go and get a qualification in Inverness even. So I was able to access this training and, you know, my life changed and my family's life changed because of it. So that is where fairness and equity comes in, and it has a huge impact on communities in rural and remote areas of Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Baird, and then I want to come back to Paul Sweeney, who obviously posed the question.
Okay, sorry. The symptoms are perfectly clear of what's happened, and the dreadful and disabling symptoms that we've all heard from rural and remote agencies that are suffering from a sick system. Now, the system is wrong because of new public management, which has had enormous benefits in technical things like joint replacements, cardiology, minimal invasive cardiology, survival of neonatal benefits. But the reason for that has been the power of the providers and boards. And I suspect the new National Centre for Rural and Remote Health will be very focused on the provider issues. And that's good because public organisations like telephones and power and water all have independent agencies that look after those who otherwise lack advocacy. And all that we're asking for is for the NHS, which had a good advocacy system in the past, is to do what other new public management systems do, which is to provide a good advocacy system, to provide what you're talking about, absolutely minimal standards. I mean, it is not acceptable for somebody to travel. And by the way, neurosurgery, at least when I was at work, goes to Edinburgh. As did neurology, which is a pathway that doesn't suit people with motor neuron disease. But there's been no advocacy for these people, and the providers are quite happy because they look at the figures and say, well, this is okay. You know, they get good results. So I think what we're asking for is quite common practice in other public management systems.
Mr. Sweeney, do you want to come back? And actually, this is where we began, Mr. Ewing. I don't know whether, having heard all that we've heard, there's anything you want to just ask as a final point. Mr. Sweeney?
I think it's been really worthwhile in the sense that it's focused on what the effects need to be, and it's effectively a check and balance on health boards and the providers to actually ensure that there is a correction where necessary through inquiry, through the experiences of people who are affected by it being given proper formal voice and able to apply obligations on the providers. So I think in that sense the petitioners' requests are significant and require further advocacy by this committee.
Mr. Ewing, you put a lot of these questions back at the start, and I just wonder whether anything occurs to you to ask any of our petitioners now, having reflected on the evidence as it's unfolded.
Well, listen with interest to what the petitioners have said, and I think there's sort of two issues. One is that several, Mr. Sinclair and our two witnesses from online are calling for reinstatement or provision of services locally, whereas Dr. Baird is calling for a slightly different additional model of advocacy, and they're both arguments have rationale behind them, so I understand that, but part of our job is to play the devil's advocate to some extent. I mean, let me put this to Dr. Baer just to see what your response is. The MSPs here represent myself, Rhoda Grant, Emma Harper, Colin Smith represent constituencies that are either largely or partly rural. So we are performing an advocacy service of a sort in the work, casework that we do, and that's a job that I suspect we all take very, very seriously. It's a big job, and we each represent tens of thousands of people. How on earth can one centralised body hope to advocate the interests of people throughout the country who are living in a plethora of remote, differing remote communities, each with their own particular needs, problems, interests and challenges? So I guess my question is, how could one centralised body perform such an enormous role effectively? How would they be accessible to people? Is there not a risk it would just be another faceless organisation adding to a number that exists already? So I'm sorry, I'm putting it a wee bit provocatively, Dr. Baird, but I'm just trying to make the point that, you know, as someone who takes very seriously advocacy for remote rural areas in my constituency, it would take me a day to go over properly a case with an individual if I do justice, because you need to really listen to be able then to represent properly that individual's concerns and articulate them. You cannot do it quickly and you cannot cut corners. And inevitably, it is very time-consuming, rightly so. So I'm just putting this, how on earth could a national agency actually be efficacious?
We no longer have a day to discuss them. So, but Mr. Baird, if you'd like to just maybe make a final comment, and then I'd just like each of the other petitioners, if there's any point, they would just finally like to contribute to our thinking as well. But if you could be quite concise, that would be appreciated at this point.
I'll do my best. It's not my forte. The first thing is that I didn't envisage this as taking on individual cases. There are plenty of ways in which that can be done, and that is what the role of all of us are, either as community groups or as politicians. The question is, there is a systemic failure here. We've clearly identified that. Science has not, over the last 30 years, which is the way I've tried to influence things, and if you want to Google me on Google Scholars, you'll see the publications that I've got before. These are not working. So what we're looking at is systemic failures. Caithness is a problem, we've got a problem, we become a more accountable issue for boards and politicians if we get together, and we benefit from shared solutions. I wasn't envisaging it as taking on individual cases. Having said that, for new public management, it's pretty common, indeed almost invariable, that there's a formal agency provided to make sure that minimal standards are applied. And so this would be minimal standards and not about excellence.
Thank you. And briefly, Rebecca Wymer. Is there a final comment you would like to contribute, Rebecca?
Yeah, no, there was. Sorry, I was waiting for my microphone to be put on. The question raised about how there would be one advocate to answer all of the questions. There already are advocacies. There already are community groups, there already are people shouting about these problems and advocating. I have a dossier of 42 women's stories who they gave them to me 6 months ago to pass around to Parliament. And I have been blocked at every single stage to try and get those stories to the people who need to see them. And an independent advocacy system that then listens to the community groups who filtered down to the members of the public. It works like the branches of a tree. And they exist already, it's just that the trunk isn't listening.
Okay, thank you. And I think if I could just come to Maria next, just a brief final comment, if you would.
Yeah. Just waiting for my microphone.
You're with us.
Can you hear me now? Yes, just echoing what Rebecca has just said and Gordon's just said, and the centralisation of professional training and qualifications, you know, needs to be governed by someone. Someone needs to make sure that examples such as the Fast Track to Midwifery course that was funded for the UHI in Inverness, a really good university that had that funding withdrawn, that needs to be monitored and assessed for fairness and the impact, you know, the equality impact on rural communities. So things like that, you know, shouldn't happen. Thank you.
Mr. Sinclair, any final thought?
Most of all the talk to now has been about maternity, but we've also had
14,000 people travelling to Inverness every year as outpatients. A colossal number of people. You know, we're trying to go green, aren't we, these days? There are 14,000 journeys going down there. And the time it takes, these people are ill. If they're travelling by train or bus, you're talking about 8 hours a travel to get down there and back again. Okay. It's a situation that must be changed, and that is what we're calling for. We're really calling for something has to change, because what we've got at the moment certainly does not work.
And a couple of sentences, perhaps each from our parliamentary colleagues who are here with us. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener, again. My thoughts would be just to add another example of in Dumfries and Galway, patients are means tested for travel reimbursement, whereas in other parts it's a given that people are supported that way. So I think the means testing is an example of how an agency could advocate to change that model. So, but I thank the witnesses here and Dr. Gordon Baird for coming to Edinburgh today as well, because it's really good to hear everybody's input, and I'll be keen to see progress with this petition. So thanks.
We should be offering them an operation while they're here, actually, having made the journey. Mr. Smith.
I think that might not go into down too well in Stranraer. I mean, people are trying not to travel to Edinburgh. They're trying to get that service a little bit closer in Glasgow. But I think a very powerful case has been made for the need for a bit of further work to look at how we advocate, or frankly, we don't advocate for healthcare in rural areas. It's not about individual cases, although collectively it will probably reveal policy failures. It's actually about trying to assist as well. The Commissioner model in Australia, for example, is about providing policy advice to government on how they tackle some of these big rural challenges as well. So I think looking at that model, looking at do we need an advocacy service to support rural healthcare in Scotland, it is a really important piece of work, and hopefully that's something the committee will certainly support going forward. It's certainly something that I very much support.
Thank you very much. And finally, Rhoda Grant.
I wonder if the committee had any discussions with the Health Committee about whether they would look at this. I know in the previous Parliament they looked at rural health care and some of the issues there, because in a way this stems right from the very start, from training of clinicians to how we support them in different areas. They're all trained to work in huge teams now. You know, when you're in a rural general hospital, you're not working in a big team. And also the standards of care, you know, they're written for urban areas. They're not transferable to rural areas. And one of the lessons that I have learned in my time in Parliament is policies written for rural areas work in urban areas, but not the other way around. So we should be turning this on its head so that we get make sure that people have access to the services they need. So I just wonder that about the Health Committee, because I think it needs a light shone on it, and it needs some detailed work to make sure that we get the changes we need. And we certainly need people advocating for our rural areas, because that's just not happening. And just on one final point, we do in the Highlands and Islands get travel assistance and accommodation. I would have to say it is absolutely inadequate when you get £40 a night to be in Inverness and you can't find a room for less than £400 a night. It's impossible. And it's actually creating a barrier to healthcare. So,
thank you for that. Yeah. And I can actually say that amongst the options the committee have considered ahead of the evidence session today is the possibility of such a referral. And that's something, when we consider the evidence afresh, that will be one of the options that is open to us to explore further. So thank you for that. We have gone 20 minutes over the time that we thought we would. So I'm very grateful to you all, because these are all very important petitions. They are thematically linked, but then individual in their own characteristics. And I very much appreciate the way that the witnesses, both online and in the room, have advocated on behalf of their petitions. These are almost, we actually historically used to hear from all petitioners, but the volume of petitions such now is that we don't. And so we all do very much value the opportunity to meet and to talk with the actual petitioners themselves and to hear you advocate on behalf of the petition that you have lodged. It's still quite a big thing to come before the Scottish Parliament and present your evidence in that way, probably thinking that you're up against a team of inquisitors. Well, I hope that's not proved too intimidating, and we've encouraged you to contribute as much as possible during the course of this session. And again, can I thank our parliamentary colleagues who've joined us for this morning's session and suspend the meeting at this point. Thank you. We're back again to consider other petitions following the evidence. Can I just agree with colleagues that we'll consider the evidence that we've just heard from our petitioners and parliamentary colleagues at our next meeting as well and review our actions at that point. We're now just going to consider other petitions. The first is a petition on which we've heard, we've taken evidence on a couple of occasions, which is petition 1804 to halt the Highlands and Islands Airport Limited's air traffic management strategy. We heard last on the 6th of May when we took evidence from Peter Henderson, and then we heard from David Amory from Prospect and Ingalls Lyon, the managing director of Highell. Rhoda Grant still with us. Rhoda, is there anything you'd like to say just before we consider how we might proceed now?
Yes, and just to echo some of the things that the petitioner said in his response to you about the radar, Sumbra radar, I share his concerns because I think he's highlighted some areas that we need to look at. When the whole ATMS project came to light, everybody agreed something had to change and safety improvements had to be made. It was just that Highell were going in the wrong direction. So radar is really important. My understanding is that there are concerns with the training that's been delivered to the new operators of radar that would be transferred across. The petitioner says that training has been ceased, so all the work that has gone on beforehand has now stopped. The training manual is being rewritten and then needs to get CAA approval. So that's going to build in quite a time lapse. It would be good to find out how many people they need to receive this training and how many people they actually have who were in training who would continue to the new programme if it's been once it gets signed off. And I also understand that the whole thing may not have been signed off by Transport Scotland as well. So we need to find out if that is the case from, I would say, Transport Scotland. And it might be well worth speaking to Nats about what they understand. They run the Sumbra radar at the moment. So they must have a date in mind, because they're under contract. They must understand what is happening there to get their understanding of when they will be handing over the radar to HIAL. So there are quite a few concerns being raised with me about that. And I also wondered if the committee had given any further thought to the suggestion about Audit Scotland looking at all of this, and if they had, maybe they would look at the transfer of radar as well.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I think over two Parliament sessions this has been well investigated by the committee. We've taken evidence from everybody, and I think the last session we had, we got assurances that it wouldn't be go ahead for 5 years. I don't think we as a Parliament could take that any further, because how many of us will be here after 5 years? So I believe the conditions in the petition, what I originally called for, have been met. So I am happy to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Stand Orders on the basis that issues raised by a petitioner now appear to be resolved.
I think that, having listened to Rhoda Grant, I think there are issues afresh, but I'm not sure that these might not be best as the subject of a fresh petition, because I do think, looking at the actual terms of the petition, that we have kind of met the objective of the petition itself. Any other colleagues have a view? Paul Sweeney?
Substantively, the issues were addressed by the petition, in the petition, and the actions resulting from it. And I think if there are subsequent areas of inquiry, then there's no impediment to the new petition that's focused on those issues being addressed by the committee in due course. You know, so if people feel it'd be a tidier exercise to do that, then. But it's kind of I'm not strong feelings either way.
Alexander Stewart.
I would agree with David Torrance, convener, that I think for this petition, it requires to come to its end, because I think we have gone through that journey. But I do think, as you've indicated, there may be subsequently something that may be afresh with a specific issue. And as Rhoda Grant has indicated, there may be aspects that may require a fresh petition to come forward looking at specifics. Because, as we've already heard, over the next 3 to 5 years, things will improve, we hope. But if there's, as I say, still issues that Rhoda Grant and the community want to bring up, I think that could be done in a new petition.
I think this has been a substantive position. It's not a question of thinking it. It absolutely has. I think the mood of the committee is to close it, but can we write to the petitioners thanking them, but also identifying the concerns that we understand they've articulated, which Rhoda Grant has articulated again today, and just pointing out that it may well be that if they feel there is a justification to do so, that would be better as the subject of a focused petition in relation to that directly. Are we agreed to that, colleagues?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just take the opportunity of thanking the committee? They've done a huge amount of work on this, taken evidence, and I think are in some way responsible for where we are now at, which is a much better position than we were when the petition was first
Well, and thank you to both you and Liam MacArthur for your considered and forensic additional cross-examination of witnesses as we progress through this petition. I hope some of us will be here in 5 years to ensure that we don't find that there's been any great. Well, maybe not in this particular. Well, David, you've been here forever anyway. But to find if there's been any progress or any reversal of the commitments given. Thank you very much. Petition number 1875, a public inquiry into the Scottish Qualifications Authority, lodged by Jordan Anderson. Do the colleagues have any comments to make? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I think what the petitioner is calling for as well has been achieved, because I would like to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders on the basis that terms of a reference of COVID-19 inquiry have now been published and will include consideration of provision of education and certification during the pandemic. But in closing the petition, the committee will also wish to draw the Education, Children and Young People's Committees to attention of the issue raised within the petition.
Thank you. So I think the petitioner in some measure has had the objectives of the petition reached. Are colleagues content to close the petition on the basis as advocated by Mr. Torrance? We are, thank you. Petition number 1897, to reform certain of the procedures for the collection of council tax, lodged by Richard Anderson. The Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Wealth, Community Wealth reiterated that council tax is a local tax set and collected by each local authority and every council financially and administratively accountable to their electorate, and states that the Scottish Government has no plans at this stage to review the processes set out for council tax regulations. And we've also heard from COSLA that they have nothing further to add to their previous submissions. Do members have any suggestions as to how we proceed now? Mr. Torrens?
I think, considering like the evidence from COSLA, that they have no further procedures to go, and the Scottish Government have no plans to review this and change it, I think we have no option but to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders.
Colleagues, are we minded so to do? We are. Thank you. That concludes this morning's meeting. We will next meet a week today, the 15th of June, when we'll be hearing from the Minister for Parliamentary Business and the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth. And I now formally close this meeting of the committee. Thank you.